Okay, I met Israel at Agile 2008, and since that time I've been corresponding with him a bit in email, and I've also been reading his blog, The Agile Executive, which some of his reflection and some of his experience really changed my perspective about how some of this stuff can be done at a level and a perspective that I wasn't really thinking of before. So turn the time over to Israel.
Thanks for the kind words, Andrew. And thanks for all your help in giving me feedback on this presentation and helping me with some of the graphics. And many thanks to Kay and to Nate and Chris and any others of the organizers whom I might not know in person, but who have pulled together this refreshing conference. I actually am reminded of the years ago when I was a student in the Israel Institute of Technology. We had the quip then that in the second year, you understand what you were taught in the first year. In the second year, you get the second year. And we have actually never figured out when do you understand the third year. When I was working on preparing this presentation, I had a feeling of the metaphorical third year being understood by me. Various things that folks in the Agile community and myself have been doing over the past 5-6 years started to make sense to me. And you can think about this presentation actually as sharing my aha minutes with you. The aha minutes are about the four principles of the manifesto, about four cultures in whose context you can apply the principles, and finally about a tool that I highly recommend to the Agile champion, the mirror. Looking at the principles, we all have been subject recently and for quite some time now to various suggestions to add a principle to the manifesto or to tweak some of the principles of the manifesto, etc. And while I have great respect for those suggestions, I do not think that those capture the heart of the matter. The heart of the matter to me is that the Agile principles are disruptive, not in a negative manner, but rather in a positive manner, pretty much along the line of Christensen's disruptive technologies. And what happens, because they are disruptive by nature, we run into intrinsic obstacles. And the secret sauce is really not about the principles themselves, but the way we apply them, either to bypass the obstacles or, if necessary, overcome them. I have actually jotted some of the experiences that I encountered along the years. For example, some companies had crossed the chasm years ago and now hide behind their bureaucracy and their processes in order not to recross the chasm. Some others had business designs where for $1 in license revenue, you were expected to produce something like $3 or $4 in professional services and customer support revenues. Some others were unable to bridge ever between contract language and agile principles. And as a result, whatever was accomplished in R&D circles could not manifest itself in terms of the business realities. And I'm sure that people here can add a very long set of painful, if not traumatic, episodes to this list. What, however, got me a little more alarmed than usual is when I read the Ken Schwaber interview in Agile Collab a few months ago. And in this interview, Schwaber speaks about 75% of the Scrum initiatives not living up to their potential. The thing that was alarming to me was we don't normally embark upon things where the odds are 3-4 against us. This is sort of does not make sense. And coming from such an authority as Schwabel, the thing that really intrigued me was the feeling of what's wrong. Namely, personally, the agile principles make a ton of sense for me. I know quite a few people whom I consider to be highly competent, to whom the principles make a lot of sense. So what is the discrepancy? How come that very, very sensible, and may I say timeless principles, lead to such a pessimistic estimate? I was fortunate about the same time to look at Schneider's classic about re-engineering your organization. And one of the things that Schneider says there was to characterize culture characterize culture as how we like to do things in order to succeed here. And in thinking about the principles of manifesto, I concluded that I could actually describe them as how we do software in order to succeed. So what happens when we roll in the first agile license into our organization? We introduce duality in the culture, and in various cases, we might actually introduce conflict between cultures. The way Agile says we would be wise to go about it may be counter to the way our corporate culture says we want to go about it. And with this thing, I started looking very, very deeply into Schneider's work. And actually, I would characterize this presentation in many ways as being application of his theories into the realm of Agile. Now, why is culture so important to the Agile champion? Take a look, please, this taxonomy of culture that is taken from Schneider's 1994 work about the He identifies four core cultures: the control, the collaboration, cultivation, and competence. And the cultures are in the top quadrants in which they look at data or pay attention to data, and according to the way in which they process it. So some cultures look at data in the future. Can I be heard? How is it now? Should I try to raise my voice or? Okay, thanks. So some cultures are looking at future data. They are all about what could be accomplished next year or the year after or maybe even 5 years into the future. Some other cultures pay attention to what is happening today. Namely, the future may be very, very interesting, but damn it, what is happening today in Georgia or any other place? The other aspect is how cultures make decisions. So some cultures are very personal. You have a charismatic leader who really carries the day. Some others are very cut and dry. Here is the data is the only thing that matters, etc. Now, if you take a look at those four cultures, I have listed here for each culture what characterizes it, what it is about. An organization which typically uses this culture, and a personification of this culture. So if you take the control culture, for example, obviously it's about power. Militaries from time immemorial tended to be control culture. And if you think about personification, surgeon is a good example. When he or she operates on me, I would very much like the person, the surgeon, to be very, very methodical, very much in control of the situation, very much driven by parameters like by blood pressure or whatever they monitor. If you go left and look at the collaboration culture, you see the nurse there as characterizing a fairly similar function in the collaboration culture. The difference, while both the surgeon and the nurse care a ton about the patient, the nurse tends to develop a much more collaborative relationship with the patient, and there is any number of studies in hospitals that the recovery of the patient depends to a great extent on the collaboration with the nurse. Now, this business of personification is actually deeper than might catch the eye. If you remember Schneider's definition that culture is a way we do things here in order to succeed, you could actually think about character as the way I do things in order to succeed. The parallel is very, very obvious. And if you accept this premise, it actually gives us a very interesting lens to look at agile rollouts. And I would call this lens the psychoanalytical lens. What do I mean by that? When we start an agile rollout, it's really like putting a plant in a soil. And the business of the fit between the two is of crucial importance. Now, going back to the four cultures that we talked about, as an agile champion, you can find yourself in any one of the four cultures. This is a given. You are operating within a certain environment. Assume for a minute that you are within a control culture. You could definitely stay within this culture, and rather than trying to change into things which are very difficult to accomplish, tried to build on the strengths of this culture. Now, various people have told me that actually control culture is very inappropriate for agile. And I beg to differ. Control culture tends to be very methodical, tends to be very rigorous, tend to be very, very good at putting processes in place. So if you are the agile champion within the control culture, you can build on those aspects and others as things that would help the assimilation of agile big time. And remember the duck, where is Kay? Staying within your culture, you are staying with a very good duck, as distinct from embarking on some adventures. Now, the other thing that you could do, you could try to move into adjacent cultures. And in this example, it is exemplified by moving from control to collaboration or moving from control to competence. And you actually need to think about it in terms of character change. You don't change your character by a 3-day blitz course someplace. If you are serious, at least in terms of Freudian theory about changing your character, it takes years, and it's a process in which you invest a lot. The returns are not in the next week or the next month or even the next year. And the opinion of various experts is that the same holds for the enterprise. You might find yourself spending a decade trying to change the culture to fit into what you would like it to be for the agile purposes. So this is a very lengthy and a high investment approach to the rollout of agile. Now, the third one is you could move all the way to the opposite culture. For example, you could try to move from control to cultivation. And I would contend that this is the equivalent of a transplant of a personality. Even if you are the founder of the company, this is something that would probably be extremely difficult and quite unlikely to fail. Now, if you take a look at this framework of four core cultures, they actually shed light on the estimate from Schwaber about 75% of failure. What happens if you go random on the way you apply Agile without any attention to cultural aspects? You have got three routes out of four, which are quite difficult. You have got two adjacent cultures and one opposite cultures. And in those, again, if you accept the psychoanalytical view, those are difficult and lengthy. And I very much doubt that anyone here has 10 years to make an agile rollout successful, as the cultural change suggests. Now, assume for a minute that you started agile and it's going very, very well. One team is doing it beautiful, a second team is doing it beautiful. And you actually, and rightly so, feel quite good about it. You expect success to beget success. I would actually contend that due to the interplay between scale and culture, success does not necessarily beget success. Jim Highsmith is talking about two ways in which you could scale. One way, you could scale up. You had 15 developers on your floor doing agile, then you had 20, then you had 30, etc. And up to a point, this is actually a very, very effective way of scaling, because A, you remain within your culture. B, you are likely to stay with the same agile infrastructure that you have used in the first few projects. So in terms of moving up, it is extremely effective, but up to a point. At a certain point in time, you lose the ability to put more people in your floor or in your building or even in your country, or you can't get the talent. And at this point in time, you find yourself scaling out. And here, all of a sudden, particularly these days, you are likely to face another culture. The guys in Moscow or in Beijing or in São Paulo have their own national culture. And instead of two cultures to think about, namely your own culture as a corporation or organization and the culture of Agile, all of a sudden you need to be very, very mindful about how things are understood and how things are done in São Paulo, Brazil, or any other place that you might be doing Agile. So what happens, the scale up at a certain point in time forces you to go into scale out, at which point in time you are likely to run into additional cultural considerations and quite complicated ones at times. There is another strategy which is quite effective up to a point, and this is scale diagonally. What I mean by scale diagonally, you take the success that you had in R&D with Agile and use it to drive success in other functions, marketing, sales, finance, etc. And people actually respond to it quite well at the beginning for the simple reason that people take notice that things are working in a very, very different manner in R&D. However, what happens is that you are trying to affect other downstream functions, you are likely to hit other cultures. The guys doing revenue recognition in your finance department are quite likely to be of a very, very different culture than the band of happy developers that are doing the code. So what happens is you can make people take notice and be responsive to change, but you need to be very mindful of how many cultures you cross when you go all the way from R&D in this example to revenue recognition. I would actually contend that you can't really go much beyond the joint agile infrastructure that you have. And by joint agile infrastructure, I mean one that each and every one of the constituencies, marketing, sales, customer service, etc., can use. And this is for the following reason. If you go back to Schneider's taxonomy of culture being characterized by the data that it pays attention and by the processes that it uses to make decisions, if you have joint infrastructure, you basically agree on the data. There may be all kinds of questions about interpretations, what it means, what will be in the future, etc. But in terms of one dimension of cross-cultural issues, you have got common base of data. In terms of process, while joint infrastructure doesn't necessarily imply that the processes would be agreed to, it oftentimes makes suggestions as to what are the processes that would make sense to use, given that there is commonality of data. So when you leave your railhead, so to speak, and branch into other downstream functions and other cultures, please be very mindful about how far your infrastructure can take you. The example that I would like to bring is from BNC in 2006. At this point in time, we were doing Agile for about 2 years, and results in R&D started being quite good. We did, however, have a ton of problems in marketing and sales being able to capitalize on it. And while we did not have anything like Schneider's taxonomy of cultures, we intuitively felt that the differences between the business and R&D are gonna kill us. And the joint infrastructure that we created was actually completely manual. We introduced a go-to-market process in which I and my colleagues on sales, professional services, customer support, etc., would meet time and time and time again to understand what are the effects of Agile on go-to-market. This was very tedious and quite primitive. However, you can imagine how much it could give us if we had a tool back then like Agile Portfolio Management, which would be meaningful both to the strategic decision making and to the operational aspects of marketing and sales. I mentioned the mirror at the very beginning, and I do not mean it in the Grimm's Brothers sense. This is not about Snow White. Rather, use the mirror when you are thinking about doing Agile to really understand your culture. Take one good look, take a second look, if necessary, take 100 looks, and get to understand the culture of your organization. And my contention is, as I mentioned with respect to the strengths of the control culture, that whatever your culture is, Agile can succeed within it. Now, let me make one crucial differentiation here. I do not doubt for a minute that certain cultures are better fit for certain endeavors. For example, if you want to wage war, at least the classical answer is that the control culture is very effective. So, take the US military. Probably, I don't know for sure, but I guess that they are a control culture. Within this control culture, a lot of wonderful things can be done by agile methods in their various data centers. And those data centers are the things that drive where the bombs go and where the artillery fires and which tracks the tanks take. So you have a control culture who is all geared to launch war, benefiting in a very significant manner from Agile within its IT infrastructure. So Endeavor may require specific culture. However, within this culture, Agile can be extremely effective in supporting what you are trying to do. There is another thing that I would suggest in this context, and this is, if you please, the behavioral aspect. And I do not pretend by any stretch of imagination to be an expert on behaviorism, that I am not. However, I would suggest to you my experience with Twitter as an example of how behavior changes. I started Twitter just because it was fun and it seemed to be interesting and was experimenting a little bit with it. And little by little, as my network grew, I have found that it completely changed my behavior. The way I go about data collection, and to some extent at least the way I go on data analysis these days, is first and foremost based on Twitter. It gives me the richness of information and the diversity of information that would have taken me a ton of time if I were scavenging the World Wide Web without my network. So here is an example of a tool which I took out of some curiosity. I never invested it more than adding another person I follow or, or looking a little bit who is there, who is not there. And what I found over time that my behavior has been completely transformed through this kind of tool. My contention is that a good agile tool, when it spans a few constituencies, can have the very same effect, and that you can change behavior of various functions without getting into big pushes about cultural changes. So, in summary, what are my suggestions, or what are my principles for the timeless principles of the manifesto? First one is to know yourself. We are all exposed to various discussions about the fine points of one agile method versus another. Important as those discussions are, I would contend for somebody who is planning to start rolling agile, they are of very little value. Where you will run into obstacles are not in the fine points of Scrum versus Kanban, but in the fine points of how your culture operates. So after a fairly small amount of investment in understanding what agile is about, shift your attention into understanding your organization and understanding your culture. Second, you need to be true to yourself when you roll agile. Don't try to assimilate the way Salesforce did it, or the way BMC did it, or any one of a number of other companies, because there is no reason to believe that their culture is similar to the culture that you are dealing with. And trying to emulate them blindly would not get you what you are hoping to get. Instead, once you understood your culture, do take the time and the effort to understand the weaknesses of the culture, the strengths of the culture, and develop your agile rollout strategy building on the strengths. Third, when you want to change the way things are being done, tools, or if you please, serious games, are the easiest way to change behavior. So if you can find a tool which, for example, would tie together the issues which are important to revenue recognition, together with the issues that are important to the guys who are doing a sprint, you are making tremendous progress. You would be able to get them together, or at least closer to one another, in much easier way than being explicit about trying to change culture. Fourth, and perhaps the most important here, You have a mirror in looking into your organization, of course. But you have another mirror, which is a feedback that you get from other cultures. The guys in revenue recognition might drive you nuts in terms of how they go about their business. However, they are doing you and your culture a great service in making you aware of your blind spots and very possibly protecting you from excesses and vulnerability of the culture within which you operate. So consider the cultural feedback from other cultures to be part of your mirror and pay a lot of attention to it. If you do so, I am very, very confident that in the next Agile Roots conference, I would be sitting in the audience and people who are listening to me now will be reporting about their successes with Agile. Thank you very much. I doubt that everything was clear, so I would like to hear some questions. Yes, please.
Do you think agile tools, since they can change behavior, are culture neutral in the sense that the same tool can be used in any of the four cultures you identified?
The question was whether agile tools are culture neutral, namely whether they can be used equally well in any of the four cultures that we have described. And I would say yes, unless you have a pathological situation in your corporate. Namely, if the excesses within a certain corporate culture are such that sensible things are not being heard, then tools might not be that helpful. However, if you assume a reasonably healthy corporate culture, which is usually the case, then I would say yes. If you take a Rally tool or version 1 tool or any one of your favorite, you don't find any strongly encoded cultural assumptions there. You find ways to collect data, ways to share data, and as those tools do more of agile portfolio management, ways to reach out to other constituencies. Diana?
I'm interested in what you're saying about building on the strengths of a current culture. And a number of folks, me and Kent Beck and some other folks have been talking lately about incorporating some of the principles and theories of appreciative inquiry into how we introduce agile into organizations. And that seems to me to be a really natural fit with the idea of building on the strengths of the existing culture. And so I was just wondering if you have any other reflections on techniques to build on the strengths that you've used.
Diana's question was about whether appreciative inquiry that she and Kent Beck and others have been discussing recently as a way to introduce Agile, whether those are consistent and fall within the concepts that we have discussed here. My answer, or to be more precise, my intuitive answer is I think they would be a wonderful fit. I have not done enough work in this area to be able to tell you or anyone else authoritatively so, but I would very much welcome the opportunity to work with you in order to enrich the set of tools that we have. So gut-level reaction, I think this would be 101% consistent, synergetic, and helpful. Yes, please.
Just building on Diana's point, the reason that Bill Schneider wrote this book was that he called it the reengineering alternative because he was trying to antidote people using the wrong method process-wise for a given culture. He was seeing everybody using re-engineering and saying, you know, that's not the answer to everything. It depends on your culture. So I think it's a huge fit with appreciative inquiry, this approach. I would recommend this. I thank you for bringing this work to this environment, because it can be very useful for people to understand their culture and to try to implement Agile in a way that's consistent with their culture instead of, you know, trying to thwart their culture, which is, you know, there's a huge bias, I think, against control cultures in our world, understandably so, but still not usefully so.
The comment that was made was that appreciative inquiry probably would be very synergetic with what we have discussed. And second, that Schneider, when he developed his framework in the 90s, was paying a lot of attention and due attention to the way that you can't really go willy-nilly about the way you try to change your culture, and that his concepts indeed seem to be quite relevant to what we do as agilists. So thanks so much for the comment. Jeff?
You use the term serious games. I mean, the other person I've heard use the term a lot is Luke Holman. Can you say a little bit more about what you meant by serious games?
If you take a look at Luke's way of, we are talking about, what's the name of his tool?
Innovation games.
It's basically not really very, very different, if you please, from playing chess or playing bridge or playing any one of another of some kinds of games that we all play from time to time just for fun. And what happens is that the fun element in working, for example, on prioritizing on backlog is in large enough sample, is good enough to overcome the tedious nature of, oh my gosh, I have got 77 stories or 77 requirements. How do I make the decisions? I would say that to me, and this may be an idiosyncrasy, Twitter is of the same nature of a game, a serious game. Obviously, I don't do Twitter for game. I get a lot of fun of it, but I thought that this would be an effective channel to interact with people. And while it might have been designed as a way to change my patterns, the fact of the matter is the fun element led me to invest sufficiently in it, and invest is writing a tweet here, a tweet there, to the point that it has become a very serious tool to me. So particularly in this era of Web 2.0 and possibly getting into Web 3.0, there are a lot of tools where the initial investment is pretty much zero, where it's very, very enticing. We can get into it extremely easily, and once the network effects kick in, the change on behavior could be immense. So for example, the use of various social network tools in the context of doing agile, particularly distributed agile, I think is an area of a great promise. And many of the tools, to me, are in the realm of serious games. In Agile 2008, Andrew here, I don't remember with whom he has done it, but he was co-coding together with one of the stars that was there at the time. And Andrew came and told me afterwards, it changed his behavior as a developer, you know, for the timing of the session. So here is a tool which any developer, if he or she chooses, could start to use, and I think it's open source, if I remember correctly.
That tool is not open source. It's called Luna, and it's a collaborative network where you can basically pair with one screen, and there's two people, and they both have a cursor on the same document. There's a couple other projects that let people do that.
That, to me, is a very serious, you know, very serious game, particularly when we are talking in the context of Agile, which, at least in part, is about the fun in programming. Sir?
The comment, the quote you started off with from Ken Schwaber, where he talked about 75% of them failing and the culture's changing Scrum, in this case, to something that was not Agile. How do I tell the difference between that and the changes that I introduced to Scrum to adopt or adapt to the culture? Should I care?
I think you should care because there is a line beyond which you might unintentionally throw the baby together with the water. So not being dogmatic is certainly something that I would highly recommend to everyone here. And if I look at my own experience, for example, with BMC, I think that the fact that we were flexible about how we applied Scrum was a big part of our success. Having said that, at a certain point in time, you might be taking too much of it by successive adaptation. Basically, when you look at Scrum, it's three roles, three processes, and three artifacts. That's simple. So any one of the three that you might take out as part of adaptation out of the equation, you have taken 11%, so to speak, out of Scrum. So you need to be careful about it. I would again suggest the mirror, particularly if you are working with a seasoned consultant, what is sensible to do in terms of adapting Scrum or any other method, and what is not sensible to do, you would get some very real feedback very fast with the next demo. So I would definitely experiment in not only in doing the software, but in doing the software method. And I would pay very close attention to the feedback because this is the best way by which we know what is right and what is wrong. As I think it was Alistair yesterday mentioned here, you can look at Kanban as putting Scrum on its ear. So here is an example of quite a change. However, there is a lot of feedback that in certain cases the change is working very, very well. So I would trust my automatic pilot and try to see, is this change working? Is this change not working? What am I doing wrong, etc. Any other questions? Thank you very much.